In this video, we will look at Axis combat training research in a world at war, how this can be prepared in Gathering Storm, and whether it is worth the cost. Before continuing, be sure to click the subscribe button to indicate your support. But first, no complaining about the title of this video. As a redhead, I can use expressions like redheaded stepchild. Anyway, people are obviously joking when they say mean things about redheads. Redheads rock, and in the context of a world at war, every player who refights Operation Barbarossa is honoring a famous redhead. If you want to know more, read Jackie Collis Harvey's great book, Red. Combat training research is one of the big three research projects in a world at war. These are Air Nationality DRM, Naval Nationality DRM, and combat training. All three significantly increase the capabilities of the Alliance obtaining the research result, although in different ways. The big three projects all have the same research profile. All require 10 plus for a result, and all have the same modifiers for intermediate results. In addition, all three have the same basic negative modifier. The higher your level, the harder it is to get an increase. An Air Nationality DRM increase has several effects. It generates a favorable plus or minus one modifier for air combat, including air combat involving strategic bombers and interceptors. It also gives a plus one modifier when attacking enemy ships. An Air Nationality DRM increase does not affect the maximum ratio of air-to-ground units for ground support and defensive air support, which is always three air factors for each ground factor, or the number of air squadrons that may attack enemy ships at sea. This second point is mentioned because at one point the rules provided that a higher Air Nationality DRM allowed more air squadrons to attack enemy ships at sea. This made Air Nationality DRM too strong, so that rule was scrapped and simplified as well. A Naval Nationality DRM increase also has several effects. It generates a favorable plus or minus one modifier for fleet combat, onboard submarine attacks, and submarine warfare, a minus one modifier for enemy air attacks on friendly ships, and more effective shore bombardment. Unlike ground and defensive air support, the ratio of shore bombardment to invading ground units goes up with the Naval Nationality DRM of the naval units used, from 1 to 1 up to a maximum of 3 to 1. A high Naval Nationality DRM is essential to large invasions. The two Nationality DRM projects give some pretty strong results. Where does this leave combat training? The Axis plan starts in Gathering Storm, where the Axis make sure they get a maximum 18-step result for specialized units. The research points for this come from several possible sources. One research point assigned each turn, research steps from possible random events, one Civil War intervention research step, if necessary, one or more top-up research points at the end of the game, as these may be assigned to Step 13 and beyond. The effect of Gathering Storm specialized unit research we are interested in is the plus two modifier for the first Axis combat training research role in a world at war. This plus two modifier offsets the minus two modifier for Germany having a starting combat training level of two. The Axis target is a world at war combat training result in 1941 for a number of reasons. The plus two modifier from the Axis 18-step Gathering Storm specialized units result only applies to the first World at War combat training research role, so the Axis have to get their result on the first try. The Axis don't have enough research points to be sure of getting a result in 1940. By waiting until 1941, the Axis might get two military general research breakthroughs, which will save a research point for combat training research. A combat training increase wouldn't be worth much in 1940 anyway, but it will be in 1941. In 1939, the Axis will have 10 research points. Four of these will be used to further combat training research. 3 research points go in military general research. With luck, this will give the Axis a military breakthrough. 1 research point goes in combat training research. This leaves 6 research points for other things. In 1940, the Axis will have more like 13 or 14 research points. 2 research points go in military general research, which guarantees a military breakthrough in 1940 if the Axis didn't get one in 1939. 2 research points go in combat training research. Several extra research points will probably be put in military production projects, so the Axis can guarantee a military breakthrough. In 1941, the Axis will have 16 or 17 research points. At least 1 research point is assigned to military general research, because the Axis want as many military breakthroughs as they can. 3 research points are assigned to combat training research. This guarantees a combat training result, provided the Axis have 2 research points they can transfer from other military projects to cover a bad research role. Every A World at War player must know the rule that allows bad research roles to be salvaged by boosting a 1 or 2 research role to a 3. This allows at least a degree of research planning. Here is a summary of the Axis research, presented visually. Of course, the precise allocations to military general research in 1940 and 1941 depend on what happens in 1939. From now on, in this video, we will use CTL for combat training level. To sum up, we know that the Axis will get an 18-step result for specialized units in Gathering Storm, and that the +2 modifier this gives them will cancel out the starting -2 modifier for combat training in A World at War. This guarantees the Axis a combat training increase in 1941. Now we will look at how this contributes to the Axis war effort. The starting combat training levels are set out in Rule 41.921. Germany, Finland, Sweden, Vlasovs, Japan, Wangs, Indian National Army, and Communist China start with a combat training level of 2. Everyone else starts with a combat training level of 1. An Axis combat training result increases the German, Finnish, Swedish, and Vlasov CTLs to 3, increases the Italian and Axis minor country CTLs to 2, and gives all Axis units a CTL advantage over the Allies, until they get their own CTL increases. Combat training is crucial for offensive ground combat. Ground combat is resolved by a roll on the combat results table. If an attack fails on the first try, a CTL of 2 allows the attacker to recalculate the odds and roll again, and a CTL of 3 gives the attacker a third roll. Units attacking with a CTL of 1 must attack at 3-to-1 odds or higher to be sure to win. A small A or a large A result doesn't get the job done. A CTL of 2 lets you attack at 2.5-to-1 odds for a sure win. In this example, 20 German factors attack 2 Russian infantry units with a defense of 8. Germany wins on a die roll of 2 or more, with some variation in the level of German casualties. On a 1, Germany loses 4 factors, but it can attack again at 2-to-1 odds with a +1 modifier. Another 1, which would be an exchange, would be costly, but Germany would still take the hex and would have a surviving armor unit if the attack was made to create a breakthrough to allow exploitation. If Germany's combat training level was 3, it can be sure of taking the Russian hex by attacking with only 18 factors. If Germany rolled a 1 in the first 2 combat rounds, it would lose 8 factors, but it could still attack yet again with 10 factors against the Russian defense of 8. A third 1 would eliminate most of the remaining German forces in an exchange, but not all of them, and a German 2-6 armor unit would survive to occupy the attacked hex. We have calculated the number of factors needed to guarantee a win in ground combat against different defenses, depending on the CTL of the attacking units. We have assumed the attacker must have a surviving armor unit to occupy the defender's hex and create a breakthrough. This table sets out the data. The defender's strength is set out on the left. If the attacker has a c-tail of 1, it needs to attack at 3-to-1 odds to be sure to win. With a c-tail of 2, fewer factors are required. The difference is listed in the fourth column, under the heading Saving. A c-tail of 3 saves even more factors, as set out in the last column, and the saving increases as the defender's strength increases. While 3-to-1 and 2.5-to-1 attacks are, on average, less costly to the attacker, when the fighting gets intense in Russia in 1942, saving 3 or 4 factors on several attacks could make a significant difference. These extra attacking factors could allow the Germans to take a key industrial center or create an additional breakthrough. Combat training increases also make attacks on fortifications less costly. Rule 15.55 also applies to seaborne invasions and is an important rule to know. If the attacking units have a c-tail of only 1, the highlighted combat results become EX-1 results, which means the attacker loses twice the face value of the defending units. That will be harsh. The defender will always retain a small d result if there are 2 defending units, because then the attacker has to invoke Rule 15.53, taking a full exchange to take the hex. With a c-tail of 2, the highlighted combat results become EX-2 results, which are easier on the attacker. Again, in rare circumstances, the defender might opt to retain a small d result. With a c-tail of 3, the highlighted combat results are converted to EX-3 results, which usually will mean the attacker suffers no losses. This doesn't mean the attacker might not suffer losses when attacking a fortification, but at least there is a reasonable chance of avoiding losses. It's also worth noting that often it is only necessary to occupy the attacked fortification with 1 factor, so a more efficient 2-to-1 attack with 1 extra factor can be made. As discussed earlier, a small d result in the final round of combat has to be converted to an EX result by the attacker to take the hex. A c-tail of 3 usually spares the attacker this decision, and the losses that go with it, because the small d result would have to happen in the third round of combat. CTLs have a big effect on seaborne invasions. Apart from the relief from invasion combat losses from a higher CTL, in the same manner as for attacks on fortifications, CTLs affect exploitation from invasion hexes. There are 3 important and related rules. Rule 41.924C provides that armor units exploiting from an invasion hex have their CTL reduced by 1. Rule 41.925C provides that armor units with a c-tail of 0 can't exploit. Rule 15.33A provides that infantry and replacements attacked on exploitation have their DM reduced by 1, provided the exploiting armor has a c-tail of 2 or more. Defending units and capitals, objectives, industrial centers, bridgeheads, and railheads are exempt. These rules have 2 potentially important effects on play. A c-tail of 3 means that German armor exploiting from an invasion hex would have a c-tail of 2, so the DM of defending infantry would be reduced. This could matter if Germany carried out a 1941 invasion of Britain. A c-tail of 2 means that Italian armor exploiting from an invasion hex would have a c-tail of 1, so it could still exploit. This could come into play if Italy invaded a vulnerable hex in the Middle East. The impact of an Axis CTL research result on Italian and Axis minor allied CTLs is also significant. Italian and minor allied units would attack like Germans normally do. This has serious implications in Egypt and also makes German attacks on the Eastern Front easier. In Egypt and North Africa, Italy can make guaranteed 2.5-to-1 attacks, or make slightly riskier 2-to-1 attacks. Even 1.5-to-1 attacks can be tried. Exploiting Italian armor units reduce the DM of defending British and Commonwealth infantry units. Attacks against British forts are also more feasible. No matter how impressed you might be by this video, there's an outside chance that the Axis will be forced on the defensive. If and when this happens, the AXIS CTL increase will still pay dividends. AXIS attrition rolls will have a plus one modifier. German units may do better in the Russian winter. And Italian units will not be subject to a minus one DM in North Africa when in partial supply. Attritions happen everywhere, but they are particularly important in the turn after a Western Allied invasion of France. Provided Germany has adequate forces, it will attrition on the 21 to 30 column of the attrition table. If the Axis attrition result lets them take a hex, the Western Allies will have to eliminate quality units to hold their bridgehead. The plus one modifier from Axis CTL research increases the chances of this happening, which makes it more difficult for the Western Allies to retain their foothold on the continent. The impact of Axis CTL research on the German defense during Russian winters is minor, but not negligible. Germany will save a unit or a hex in the 1941 and 1942 winters. The effect of Axis CTL research in North Africa will be greater. If the Axis don't wish to trace sea supply to North Africa because they aren't attacking, or if they simply can't supply North Africa, leaving the Italians in partial supply won't hang them out to dry. This has the added benefit of giving the Axis the option of declining to trace sea supply on some turns, which might help preserve the Italian fleet. The entire Axis plan started with an 18-step specialized unit research result in Gathering Storm. This has other benefits, besides the plus two modifier for a World at War combat training research. Germany starts with three of its airborne units in its force pool. Italy also starts with its airborne unit and the ability to airdrop it using an Italian Army air factor as an air transport. This enhanced airdrop capability can create a wide range of opportunities. There was a lot of information in this video, including an Axis research plan that lets it get a combat training increase in a world at war without wrecking their other research, how an Axis CTL increase affects offensive ground attacks, including against fortifications, and the other benefits of an Axis CTL increase, especially for defense. Speaking only for myself, I think Axis combat training research may well be yet another great red-headed success story.
Outside the barracks, by the corner light, I'll always stand and wait for you at night. We will create a world for two. I'll wait for you the whole night through. For you, Lily Moore.